When I first wrote my book, there was no self-help section in a bookstore. And today you will find it's the largest growing section in all bookstores.
Mm-hmm. Your books, 35 million copies sold. Mm-hmm. It's special.
I think that one of the reasons that I'm so popular is I remove the guilt from people. We grow up with so much guilt. We're wrong. We've done this wrong. We've done this wrong. We've done. Well, see, we've made mistakes, but we're not bad people. And if we learn that we can let those things go and make different choices, it takes a huge burden off of us.
Happiness is a big theme. I'm really interested in what that word means to you.
Well, happiness is choosing thoughts that make you feel good. It's really very simple. I feel good. I have a lot of energy. I know how to take care of myself. I choose the thoughts that make me feel good. So at 82, I have really good energy. And if you will be very careful about the thoughts you think, that you choose to think, because remember, somebody who has depression is choosing thoughts that make them feel rotten. You can have control over your thinking.
And what does it take to have that control? Just practice?
Well, it's observing, to start being observing. Instead of just having all these thoughts that make you feel miserable or scared or anxious or whatever, start noticing what you're thinking. You know, why am I thinking that? Why am I choosing to think a thought that's making me feel so awful or is making me feel bad about you? Why am I doing that? I don't have to do that.
And I guess for me as a scientist, the interesting question is, what are the limits of the control? Are there any? Or is it, does it have no limits?
The universe is unlimited. I like to talk about the totality of possibilities. And we can't even begin to describe those.
I met a woman recently who has ovarian cancer. Mm-hmm. And she's going through chemotherapy. She's listening to your seminars. She's learning meditation. She's got a very positive attitude.
It's a wake-up call.
Yeah, and that's really how she describes it.
She's paying attention.
But when I ask her why she has cancer, one of the answers she gives me is, she says, well, it's possible that I failed to forgive somebody in my life.
And it's one of the biggest causes of cancers.
Yeah, say more about
that. It's a contributor. Well, you know, it's like resentment that's long held eats away at the body.
So I'm a scientist, and I stand up in front of crowds, and I tell them things. And if they said, how do you know? Mm-hmm. How do you know what you're saying is right?
I would tell
them, here are data. Let me show you the evidence. Okay. Let me show you the process by which I came to this conclusion. Mm-hmm. So how do I know? How does Louise know that what she's saying is right?
Oh, it's right for me.
But you're telling it to millions of people, and you're telling them it's right for them, too. And I'm just wondering, how do you know?
Well, I'm telling them what's right for me. My inner ding, that's all I can say.
Even if there were no proof for what you believed, or even if there was scientific evidence against it,
well, I don't believe in scientific evidence. I really don't, because it constantly changes. People, this is a scientific fact. And then 3 years later, they're saying, oh, no, that wasn't right. Well, this is the scientific fact. And it keeps changing. It's only for the moment. That's my belief.
Is it an imperfect process, or is it one we should just discard entirely?
I think it's part of a learning process. And science is fairly new. It hasn't been around that long. We think it's such a big deal, but it's, you know, it's just a way of looking at life. And we'll find another way.